So the cool Nikkei One, a phone that really should be marketed properly instead of saying things that aren't true at all.
Till I get up, time is barely on our side. I don't wanna waste what's left. The storms we chase are leading us, and love is all we'll ever trust. Yeah, no, I don't wanna waste what's left. And on we'll go, through the wastelands, through the highways, till my shadow turns to sun rays. And on we'll go, through the wastelands, through the highways. And on we'll go.
So why am I saying this, and why am I starting with this? Well, to start off, I think it's important that you are honest to your consumer. And with the cool Nikkei One, they are saying it had a curved display, which it doesn't. They have rounded glass, and that gives the illusion that it has. And that it has a proper dual camera, which again, it doesn't. It creates a circle, and that's just it. Either way, let's get into the review after saying what I needed to say about the phone and its marketing. So let's start with a fresh look without looking at its marketing. Well, then I can say that this phone actually looks really good. It feels good in the hand and it looks to be above its budget. I'm surprised that budget phones can be like this. Did it take clear cues from Samsung? Yes. Does it matter? No. Overall, this phone is really pleasing to look at and it's pretty heavy with 210 grams. However, that also makes it somewhat feel nice in the hands. And a plus for this phone is that it has a headphone jack, and I will keep saying it, do not remove a useful feature if the other feature has more downsizes to it. Next to the headphone jack we have a micro USB port and of course our speaker and mic, with sound coming out of this device being pretty bad. Of course we have a power button on the right and a slightly too high placed volume button on the left, leaving the SIM and a micro SD slot on top. And of course, following the latest trend, it features an 18.9 ratio display that looks pretty good. It has a nice punch to it and it is a 6-inch Full HD IPS panel. Honestly, it's one of the better displays that I've seen on a budget phone like this. Still not curved like they claimed though. With a screen size this big, having an 18.9 ratio also makes sense. However, watching videos is still better on a 16.9 ratio display. But it would be harder to hold properly because the phone would be wider, of course. The biggest problem for me, however, is something simple. When you just want to look at your notifications, you either have to use your fingerprint scanner or your power button. If it's laid down flat on the table and you just want to quickly look at notifications, you cannot. Unlike Samsung, it doesn't seem to know that you are pressing on the display. A small feature like that would make it much easier. And I'm not sure why they didn't implement it or couldn't implement this. But let's look in terms of specs what you are getting for this price. You will get a MediaTek MT6750T CPU, 4GB of RAM that is running at 833MHz, 64GB of internal memory which you can expand via microSD, and it has a pretty decent 3190mAh battery that easily lasts you through the day. And it runs on Android 7.0. And with these specs, it really doesn't set itself apart from other budget phones out there. There are a lot of budget phones out there with the same specifications. And like those budget phones, it's not the fastest phone out there. However, it does work smoothly when you are just using the phone. The animation is good as well, so I gotta give them props for that. So let's talk about the one thing that I pay a lot of attention to, and that is its camera. Here it becomes pretty bad, and I'm not talking about the horrible sound that you are getting when you're trying to focus. It just takes pretty long to focus on an object in the first place, and once it does, it still feels like it didn't capture that focus properly, and that is really a shame. Well, it works a dual camera from Sony that is a 60 megapixel sensor and a 2 megapixel sensor, it just doesn't leave any impression with me apart from it just really falling short on this department. its dynamic range isn't good, and most of the times the background is just overexposed, which is a shame when it comes to taking outside pictures that can be pretty decent over time, but have this overexposure on the background that is really bad. Should you expect perfect pictures and a good dynamic range and no overexposure at all for this price? No, but the overexposure is quite bad. It is a shame though, because I was somewhat pleased with this phone until it came to that camera. In terms of video recording, you can record videos in full HD up to 30 frames per second. And while it has electro image stabilization, videos are of course not stable at all, which you should expect from a budget phone. But overall, the quality is just below average. So if you buy a budget phone in the hopes that you get the best camera for that price that you can get on any budget phone out there, then you really shouldn't go for this one. I honestly would advise you to look at the Xiaomi Redmi 5, which I will review as well. That one just seems to be the overall better phone, however, it just doesn't look as pleasing as this one, and the display on this one seems to be nicer than on the Xiaomi. So, would I advise this phone? Well, if you don't care too much about its camera, then yes, I would. The display is good and the fingerprint scanner works really fast. The design is very well done and it's just an overall pleasing phone for its price. It's just a shame that they focused on making a dual camera for marketing instead of making a single camera that works better. So what are your impressions of this phone? Do you like it? Either way, I will place a link in the description for my sponsor Banggood.com with this option, but also some other options including the Xiaomi Redmi 5. So you can check it out yourself and see what you think. Either way, have a good one and talk to you guys in the next.